Hello and welcome to WFTDA.tv, live right now on Twitch.tv. Now, WFTDA is the Women's Flat Track Derby Association, and if that's all new to you, well, you're in the right place to learn all about it in the most exciting way. We are broadcasting live from the 2019 International WFTDA Playoff, live right now in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. We're also graciously hosted by Greensboro Roller Derby and WFTDA. I'm Death Nella, hailing from Regina, Saskatchewan, Canada, joined by...
I'm October Revolution. I'm here from Minneapolis, Minnesota, not that far away from you.
Yeah, it's exciting. And we, of course, are connecting right here in the place that brings everyone together, the Roller Derby Hub. And right now, it is the postseason playoff time. Yeah. And there's a lot going on.
Absolutely. We want to welcome you here to the first of two playoffs. WFTDA is proud to bring you in 2019 postseason. Followed next weekend, there's a playoff in Seattle, Washington, and our championships will be in Montreal. That's November 15th through 17th.
And there's a lot at stake for this tournament in particular. You're going to see teams Paris Roller Girls and Dos por Cuatro Roller Derby playing for a spot to that champs that October Revolution was just talking about, because the top three teams in this finish, well, they make it there, but this is the first quarterfinal of the day.
If you want to learn more about the postseason and how you can watch or attend in person, because if you're in Seattle or on the West Coast, you can head on over to the Tournament Central on WFTDA.com to see all of the events. Also today, if you haven't bought your watch passes yet, we're giving away two watch passes today in the Twitch raffle.
Ooh, that's exciting.
Watch passes will give you unrivaled access to the best roller derby in the world this postseason.
And I just want to add to that, the watch passes also allow you to do things on demand. Watch when you get home from work if you need to. You don't have to stay off social media so you don't get the results spoiled for you. But it just allows you that access that you can really only get on WFTDA.tv. Now, if you are new to roller derby, you can head on over to WFTDA.tv to watch one of the many Roller Derby 101 videos. But you can also find them in the chat. And right now, we have one for you just to tee things up as well.
Roller Derby is played in increments called jams. Each jam lasts up to 2 minutes. Both teams field up to five skaters at the start of the jam. Four of these skaters are called blockers, and one is called the jammer. The jammer wears a helmet cover with a star on it and scores points for the team. The blockers are playing both offense and defense at the same time, and together they make up what is called the pack. The two jammers start each jam behind the pack and must get through all of these skaters for an initial pass before they can begin to score points. When the initial pass is complete, a jammer can score 1 point for every opponent they pass with their hips. The first jammer out of the pack legally is declared lead jammer, which means they can end the jam anytime they want before the 2 minutes are up. Sounds easy, right?
And we hope you enjoy that. Don't forget that today's game on Twitch has all kinds of fun. We've got that watch pass giveaway at halftime that I just mentioned, and there's also a roller derby quiz so you can test your knowledge or learn something about the WFTDA gameplay and history. And if you've never seen the game before, you've never been to a WFTDA tournament, here's a little slice of what you're missing from our other playoff events.
There really is nothing like the fast-paced action of Flat Track Roller Derby. We are now going to throw it down to Sissy Splasek, who is going to hold it down on the sidelines for today.
Hey, thanks, y'all. Sissy Splasek here from Atlanta, Georgia. I'm going to be hanging out down here at the sideline, really checking everything out, being on the ground, getting to see all the cool stuff you might not get to see from home. I'm going to be back here at halftime with Lady Trample from Denver Roller Derby and Chicks and Bulls. And after the game, stay tuned for a post-game interview. And if you have any questions for Lady Trample, our announcers, or anyone else, put them in the chat. We're going to answer them. All right, back to y'all.
Thanks so much, Sissy. Let's take a closer look at today's matchup for WFTDA on Switch. We've got Dos Por Cuatro Roller Derby from Buenos Aires, Argentina. They're the fourth seed in this tournament. They're currently ranked 12th in the world as per the WFTDA rankings. And they'll be playing the Paris Roller Girls from France. And they opened their tournament play already here in Winston-Salem. They had a huge upset.
Yeah, it was a game.
Santa Cruz Derby Girls seeded 12th in this tournament. Paris is only given a 4% chance of winning that game. They won it. They broke all your brackets, and it's going to be a big, exciting game here. They're currently ranked 27th in the world.
It was just one of those games. I mean, it's the first to open the tournament. You don't really know what to expect, and then you go out there, and every single jam, it's back and forth, and wow, it was quite something. Now, that's because both these teams, well, they're vying for a spot now in the semifinals. The winner of this bout will go against the winner of the bout immediately following this, and that is the matchup of Texas Roller Girls and Atlanta Roller Derby. And the top three teams at playoffs, as I mentioned earlier, here in Winston-Salem, will be headed to the 2019 International WFTDA Championships in Montreal, Canada, this November. All right, now it's time to get acquainted with our skaters. Tober, take it away.
I'm going to read you the roster for Dos Por Cuatro Roller Derby. We have number 03, Tamiz, number 14, Mandarina, number 1807, Dixon, number 24, Laricio, number 26, Tropical Mechanica, that's the captain, number 265, Lulazon, number 3, Carla, who's wearing the A, number 35, Kureisha, number 45, Maki Lumbera, number 7, Rasho, number 84, Persephone, number 9, Loba, number 99, Chinaski, and on the bench is Andre Hansen.
And for Paris Roller Girls, we have number 021, Track Sparrow, number 101, Charlie, number 141, Bonnie Tagal, number 17, Lux, number 18, Miss Gadon, number 22, Rosien, wearing the C for your captain, number 31, Avocado, number 333, Super Cute, number 34, Bisson, number 3615, Tamer, number 4950, Star, number 5-4, Bully Bunker, and number 6-9, Louisette Bonbon. And your coaches for Paris are Casperin and Waldo.
Yeah, and for those of you who are new to Twitch, make sure you sign up for your Twitch account. You're able to access the chat. We're going to raffle off some watch passes later in the broadcast. You're going to want to be signed up and chatting with us in order to enter. And also there's that fun trivia at halftime as well. If you want to subscribe to our channel, you can watch all of our previous content as well as this game on our WFTDA Twitch channel.
And we want to welcome all those. We can see you in the chat right now saying, hey, I don't really know what's up. Well, this is the game to watch. We're going to show you what flat track roller derby is all about. The rules, well, they have changed even from last year. If perhaps you joined the postseason action last year, there are some changes. Tober and myself will be taking you through that. And this is a very exciting matchup, though, because for Paris, anyway, they've already exceeded expectations coming into this tournament. As we mentioned, that huge upset from this morning, but also exceeding their position from last year. They only were in the first round at A Coruña, Spain, in the playoffs there. So they're excited to keep this momentum going. But Dos Por Cuatro, wow. They're also a powerhouse.
It's true. And the last time these two teams played was in February of 2018, and Dos Por Cuatro won 182-78. So that's kind of a decisive victory. But that said, Paris did show up today and completely surprise and shock everyone. I would say their one-on-one blocking is unrivaled. Their bridging was fantastic. They were able to hold jammers for almost half the track sometimes. And I think that's what Dos Por Cuatro is going to want to watch for and to break down if they want to be able to put some space in the score between these two teams.
So one of the things that you just mentioned, Tober, is all the fantastic vocabulary that we have in roller derby. We're going to start with the basics. Jammer is your point score. They're the one wearing a big star. It's a helmet cover. They can take that off, and we'll explain if that happens why and what the purpose is. As well, you have your blockers. They are everybody else on the track trying to get in the way and do exactly what it says right there. Block.
Yeah. And you score points by passing a block. But if you were the jammer, you can score points, and that's the only person who can, so look for that star. And you score points by passing the hips of a blocker.
And the objective of this game, well, other than winning it, of course, is collecting the most points. And as we said, we'll go through it, and we will also get to our fantastic officials in just a moment. We have a great roster lineup of skating and non-skating officials, but that whistle right there, well, that signals the start of the game. We have Tropical Mechanica out there for 2x4 with the star, as we talked about, the jammer and star for Paris with the star on her helmet. We are now moving into what we call turn one on the track. Derby is played in a counterclockwise direction. That's the way it's facing. Now, of course, you are allowed to move back and forth, but the main direction is counterclockwise. And right now, we have lead jammer status assessed to Tropical Mechanica.
The lead jammer has the ability to end a jam early. So you see there's a 2-minute jam timer there. The lead jammer can call off that jam by tapping her hips. So she has control over this jam.
A jam is essentially a round, if you will, within the game. Each half or period is a half an hour, 30 minutes.
That's going to be the end of that jam. Looks like 8 points on the board for 2x4, giving them the first score in this game, 8-0 so far, and just about a minute and a half ticked off our clock.
So that jammer, as you can see in the replay, is coming up against what we would call a wall of blockers from Paris, gets by an exit. There is an engagement zone, so it's not as though you can chase a jammer down forever and ever, because otherwise you would never be able to get out and start scoring points again. All right, we have Lulazan out there for 2x4 and Tamer for Paris.
Looks like a direction of play penalty is called on the pivot from Paris. The pivot can accept the star, can accept the star and become the jammer sometimes, but not always. We'll tell you when it happens. How about that?
And for those wondering, no, this is not at all staged. We do not know what is going to happen in this bout, other than the teams are going to play some really intense roller derby, as I mentioned, for a spot in the semifinals here, WFTDA International Playoff, Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
That's Tamir, who is the jammer who's in control of whether or not the jam keeps going or ends, has scored 4 points. Remember, you score points by passing blockers, and the blockers are everyone who doesn't have a star on their helmet.
Yes, and you have to pass them, of course, upright and inbounds. You can't just hop to the ground and hope for the best there. You need to pass their hips legally. The most important thing is the more you can see that jammer exit, the better, because that means they've put those points, collected them, and put them away.
What you're seeing now is kind of a little bit of a scrum, but it's the two teams trying to create it's either a brace two-wall or a tripod. They want to slow the jammer down by kind of wedging them in, and that person skating backwards is able to help control and slow the speed of the jammer who's pushing through.
And so that's the end of that jam. Jams can only last a maximum of 2 minutes, and sometimes a jammer, if they're being quite successful and their blockers are providing great defense, they might run that clock for the full 2 minutes. Otherwise, it might be more strategic to call it off quickly and stop the other team from scoring any points, just like we saw Paris collecting 12 there on that last jam and shutting out 2x4.
Yeah, that makes the score 12-8. And we're beginning now jam number 3. Jamming, we have Besson for Paris and
Reo. I believe. Oh, Rasho.
Yes, for 2x4.
And we're seeing the pack, as we call it, that's the collection of jammers, being spread out a little bit on the track. But meanwhile, Rasho, has lead jammer status. It's coming through. Oh, great shot. Exiting the pack quickly. Now, of course, if you're the other team, you really want to slow that down, make it so much more difficult for that jammer to simply skate on by.
We'll use the word pack a lot. What we're talking about is kind of the largest grouping of those blockers that we talk about. So when you look, it's kind of all these skaters who are playing simultaneous offense and defense, that would be the pack, what we consider that.
Yeah, derby is one of those very interesting sports where skaters, athletes, you are demanded to play both offense and defense within your given position. It isn't just you're dedicated to one thing. And sometimes it looks as though things aren't moving anywhere, but that is just really effective defense, as we can see, holding back the jammer.
Yeah, and because every 2 minutes, somebody else can be in control of gameplay, right? Because lead jammer is awarded again every single jam. Time is a very important element in this game, either slowing it down or speeding it up. You're able to get control of the game again if you don't happen to have it at the moment. That's 8 points so far for Rachel.
And the pack itself, not particularly fast in this case, and there's many reasons for that. We've also seen an interesting maneuver. The Pivot, who's the one with the stripe on their helmet, well, they have taken the star, but in that got a cut track penalty, because if you get knocked out of the track, you can't just simply re-enter.
You can hear, you can see it. We have a replay here. This is when I was calling one-on-one defense earlier, and Paris is doing it. That's what it is. Like, you kind of break out from the pack, and you slow down that jammer, and you can extend the engagement zone or how long you can block. So the jammer that's sitting in the penalty box for Paris will sit for 30 seconds, unless the other jammer goes to the box. So 30 seconds now, only Dos Por Cuatros can score.
That's right, because Loba is out there with the star, I believe, for the first time this game. And this is what we call a power jam. What we started with was a power start. Of course, a really great benefit for the offense, because all you got to focus on is providing offense. And we're seeing the Paris jammer being released from the penalty box, now coming up on that dos por cuatro lane, blocking line, rather. The action staying now in turn one.
Yeah, this right here is what sometimes will be called a brace two-wall or a tripod. And look how effective it is in slowing there, sticking that jammer. That jammer can't really get around it. And that person in the front can direct those two blockers in the back where they can go, as well as, you know, keep them from being pushed forward by, you know, forward momentum.
And there we see the Pivot, the skater with the stripe on her helmet, simply try to provide a little bit of offense before having to quickly turn back to defense. And sometimes you might wonder, well, how come that jammer can't just simply skate in the free lanes? Well, we just saw there Miss Gadon shutting the door there on lane one. You're not getting by. When we refer to lanes in roller derby, it's just simply some pathways, invisible pathways rather, on the track itself, from the inside, which is closest to the center, to the outside.
Just helps us kind of talk about three-dimensional space mm-hmm. a little bit easier.
Now, both myself and Tober have skated, and it is really interesting. You lose a lot of spatial awareness when you start and you're out there, even though it's a flat track. We have been seeing some comments there on Twitch about Whip It. That is bank track roller derby, a little bit different to what we're doing here.
I want to thank the Twitch watchers and subscribers. Thank you so much for hanging in there, listening to us, learning about roller derby, watching roller derby, and subscribing to this great channel where you can see even more roller derby action.
And of course, if you're just joining us, well, you're in the middle of a replay from the last roller derby jam that just occurred. Dos por cuatro from Buenos Aires, Argentina, taking on Paris Roller Girls from Paris, France. And it's all happening, guess where? North Carolina.
So in this time, I have some time to read to you the officials. The skating officials today are Refty Venture, PH Demon, Shanksy, Adam Smasher, RDFM, Gym Class Hero, and Shaka Mike.
And for your non-skating officials, we have John Brawls, Judge Booty, Big Brad Wolf, Diamond Tiara, This'll Be Painful, W.E.B. Destroys, P.D. Rulebooker, Omiez. And there is another name there. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it right, so we're going to say Le Corbusier and hope for the best. We have some wonderful international non-skating officials and skating officials joining us. Of course, the non-skating officials are the ones running everything behind the scenes, the penalty tracking, penalty timing, jam timing, yeah, and the rest.
So timeouts, what we just had, every team gets three timeouts throughout the whole game. The timeouts don't replenish at halftime. And they can use those clock stoppages whenever they want, and they're a minute long. They also get an official review each half, and we'll talk more about those if they happen later. So just know that, you know, Paris has used one of their three clock stoppages for the whole of this game.
You can keep track with us on screen, those bars underneath the names of the teams, and the names above the teams are the jammers in play right now. And that little star that you see beside Tropical Mechanica means she has been assessed lead jammer status. And we see a successful star pass. Paris has used this a number of times. So the only other skater who can wear the star in a game is the Pivot, the one with the stripe on the helmet cover. if the star is passed successfully between the two skaters.
So what you just saw there was the gentleman from Dos Por Cuatro is watching the pack, watching the other skater, both ticking time off the clock, tiring out Paris's skaters, and then calling off the jam right before Paris score points. That's the kind of control that a lead jammer really can exert over a game. And it's a beautiful power when you have it.
And here we see a replay of the moment that... looks at that's the moment that the Dos Por Cuatro jammer was able to get out of the pack. Meanwhile, the Parisian jammer having to go all the way back. And we'll talk about that more in just a moment as we get back into gameplay here. Lulazan with the star for Dos Por Cuatro and Star with the star for Paris. And right now, the pack being the collective group of blockers, doing an effective job making sure that no one has been assessed lead yet. You only get lead if you successfully pass, legally successfully pass, all of the blockers through the pack and leave the engagement zone.
That is a direction of play penalty called on the pivot from Paris. Direction of play just basically means you impact someone, knock them down, or get in front of them while skating clockwise on the track instead of counterclockwise.
And for those wondering about that position of the pivot, as mentioned, is the only other skater who can take the star from the jammer if the jammer decides to relinquish that helmet cover. Now, there might be a number of reasons for that. Perhaps they are stuck in the pack themselves and they want to be able to get the points scored for their team. But it does mean an automatic loss of lead jammer status if you have lead jammer and you take that helmet cover off with intention.
That is Lulazan through the second for a second scoring pass. 8 points total on this jam. The score right now is 39-12.
And Bonnie Tagal with the star for Paris having to be drawn all the way back to the back of the pack, coming back in legally. When you do get bumped out either to the inside or the outside of the flat track and your blocker who has hit you out doesn't go with you, well, you have to line up behind everyone who is already in a superior position than you on the track. So lots of awareness required. I myself, not so great at it. This is why I'm calling, and I'm able to announce instead.
It's a really good way to control the jammers, to keep the jammers what we call stuck in the pack or unable to score more progressive points while your jammer is scoring points. So you'll hear people call it recycling or pushing back, and that's what that is. Here you go. This is a beautiful replay of Lulazan able to streak by 1 foot, is upright and in bounds, and gets passed and gets those points. 12 actually on the jam, 43-12 right now.
And if you're someone who cares about clocks and sports, well, between each jam is 30 seconds. That gives everybody a chance to reset their lines, send out new lines. And we do have, when you hear whistles, there's a lot of whistles in Derby, and depends how loud the feed is for those. But normally when you hear a single whistle blow during play, well, that can indicate a penalty. Penalties are served 30 seconds apiece. You can get back-to-back penalties. And right now, it seems like there's not a lot of action happening, but this is where the real work goes on. And Tober, I don't know if you want to tackle bridging, because that's what we're seeing right now.
Okay, so the pack is the largest grouping of blockers within 10 feet of each other, right? And the engagement zone is 20 feet on either side of the pack. So when you see those bridges, or when people putting, you know, those people just kind of standing in the middle, they're extending the engagement zone so that the jammer isn't let go at the front or let go at the back without anyone able to block them. So when you see kind of people standing around, what they're doing is basically extending the area that roller derby can be played in.
And one thing, just watching the Twitch chat out of the corner of your eye, lots of questions about how is it that they're able to not injure themselves or twist their ankles? Well, that's because roller derby has now become a sport. You really have to be fit to play because of the level and the intensity that it's been taken to since its start, really, in the early 2000s, the flat track roller derby part of it anyhow. And you're basically cross-training, you're working really hard, and here we see a look at some of that physicality. It is a full contact sport that we are watching, and safety is paramount. at all times.
Yeah, I would say that, like any sport, there's protective training that people do on their joints, on their ankles, on their knees. And we have a cut at the front of the pack by Busson. This is going to be a power jam, or only one jammer on the track for Dos por Cuatro. That is Loba, who is jamming right now and is lead for them.
Woo, Loba coming up against a really tough opponent there. Trying to make out the number on the back, that 021 track sparrow. Now, Paris has already played a game today. They opened up the tournament here in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, with a major upset. They are seeded 12th in this competition, and they were able to take the win over the fifth seed by 3 points. So sometimes you see, you know, derby points kind of starting to rack up. You're not sure, you know, how much of a gap is a big gap. Well, the thing with derby is one jam can make the difference. And right now, Dos por Cuatro is leading Paris.
Okay, we're about halfway through this first half. There's an hour of playtime in roller derby. And of that playtime, it's split into two halves. So we're in the first half of the game. And we're about halfway through it.
And sometimes we don't, we're not able to single out blockers all the time for their work, because both of these teams have been phenomenal at keeping their blockers together and working as a force. The one-on-one, it can be good. It can at least slow down a jammer, but you really want to try to keep your pack together. You're just so much stronger, and you're able to move laterally across the space to shut out any potential pathways for that jammer to get through.
Speaking of that, we have some strong defense here by Paris, holding back the blocker from Dos por Cuatro, who is on a scoring pass. It's going to allow some time for that star pass or the jammer helmet cover being handed to the pivot. Paris is able to successfully do that and force a call off, force the end of the jam. And that's going to be four for them, a good penalty kill, as they say. They being me in roller derby. Don't forget, we'll raffle off watch passes in this game, so stay tuned at the end of this half.
Yeah, because roller derby isn't always here on Twitch.tv, and right now you're getting a great replay look at that blocking work by Paris to keep Dos por Cuatro's jammer out and drawing her right back. And if you are joining us on Twitch for the free stream, thank you. We're very happy to have you. Please keep chatting. We have folks happy to help point you in the right direction of resources if you want to learn more about this incredible sport. Roller derby is currently being played on six continents.
The seventh is Antarctica. There's nobody playing roller derby in Antarctica.
Right.
I just had to say it. I'm sorry.
No one yet. All right. Tropical Mechanica with lead jammer status for Dos por Cuatro. And Louisette Bonbon with a star for Paris. And what you're seeing, that big, thick horizontal line kind of coming towards you to the screen there right now. It's on the left of your screen. That is the jammer line. That is where everyone starts from, or rather the jammers start behind and your blockers start in front of. And then when they blow that whistle, that's when skaters, athletes can move around and get in place, jockeying for position on defense or offense, whatever is most needed at the time.
Now you can't see, you can't easily see who Paris's jammer is right now because of, she's doing what we call a star sash, or holding the helmet cover. But if you look, Louisette Bonbon is holding it out, and I can't tell if she's trying to do a star pass or she's just holding it. And that's the beauty of the star sash.
Yes, you are allowed to take that helmet cover off as a jammer and put it back on, but you aren't allowed to hide it. Back in the day, jammers used to get real sneaky and really hide that helmet cover, which was, of course, know, a bit of an advantage. You don't know who your jammer is.
Well, I mean, it didn't help the referees either.
No.
They also didn't know who the jammer was.
And we'll talk a bit more about the reffing throughout this game,
yeah,
because that is also a complex game of its own, I'll say. And Tober, I know you refereed as well. And
I
we
did.
Also had people volunteering to referee in Antarctica. So whoever wants to get that league up and running, you've got skating officials and non-skating officials on board.
Score now is 66-12. We have 12 minutes left in this half. That was an 11-point jam for Dos por Cuatro. Paris being held scoreless for quite a while.
And here we see Dos por Cuatro's jammer running the inside line, staying in bounds. And there was that referee following along. That is a jammer ref who's solely dedicated to skating alongside either team's jammer. which is pretty incredible. You don't always get that in other sports. So to have a dedicated referee just for your position, not only to call penalties on you, but on anyone who wants to do you wrong on the track. Right now, the pack is stretched out. Bridging is taking place. We have skaters standing there trying to stretch out the engagement zone, and that's all based on position, relative position. It's way too scientific for right now if you're brand new. Just keep watching the action. It's really exciting.
Don't forget, Paris Roller Girls came in ranked 27th in the world. They had a huge upset this morning. They're playing the 12th in the world, those por cuatro.
From Argentina, we're seeing lots of pride for Argentina and France here today. We are playing in the United States. I'm from Canada, so there's just a lot of international love happening here, and that's really exciting. And we're really glad wherever you're joining us from in the world, we are glad to have you on board.
Thank you so much to our Twitch audience. We love to see you in there. You're interacting with each other and enjoying this sport, and thank you so much for being here with us.
And now, we did mention you can win some watch passes to WFTDA.tv, but you can also get the schedule of our free Twitch games at WFTDA.tv/Twitch.
Jimmy, now we have Tamer up against Russia.
And a bit of a pileup going back and forth. Now, contact is allowed. There are certain positions on the body it's not allowed, and that's when you will see penalties called. You cannot really use, you can't use your forearms, certain things like that. The idea of old school derby where you could elbow someone, not allowed.
This is going to be 10 jams now that Paris has been held scoreless. Four more points for Dos por Cuatro, 78 total for them. We're up to 12. Remember the last time these two teams met in February of 2018, the score was 182-78. I don't know math great, but I think this is a bigger, this is, would project out to a larger differential so far.
And one thing that I caught my eye on Twitch as well is we are talking about lead jammer status. What does that mean? That doesn't necessarily mean you have the lead in the game or that you've actually scored more points in the jam. It simply means you have control of how the jam ends in that time. If you want to strategically call it off, effectively cutting that jam short of the 2 minute maximum that it can possibly run, you can do that to your advantage.
Speaking of that, so far 9 lead jams have gone to Dos por Cuatro, only one to Paris. This could have been one for them, but you saw that the Paris jammer did not get lead jam. That hand signal the ref was doing was saying that she didn't pass every player upright and in bounds. She passed one out of bounds, or they were out of bounds or out of play, and so she was not awarded lead jammer. Lead also didn't go to Dos por Cuatro. This will be a 2 minute jam. We haven't seen one of these quite yet, so this is your first 2 minute jam of the game.
So yeah, it is going to run the full time. And of course, you can have multiple, well, there's no set number of jams per se within a half. The half runs for 30 minutes. Jams, of course, can run anywhere from a couple seconds to the full 2 minutes like we're going to see here.
And just a quick refresher, the jammers, or the skaters with the stars on their helmet, can score points by passing the blockers, which the other skaters on the track, by getting their hips in front of them upright and in bounds. Basically, you score points by skating past people from the other team.
And I enjoy seeing comments about, well, their bodies are their weapons. It's true. Yeah, you're not interacting with, say, a ball like in other sports or having to hold anything. You are fully in control of positioning yourself to get in the way. And in this case, they did just that. And a forearm penalty called on Dos por Cuatro's jammer will send her to the penalty box. And that obviously gives Paris Bisson the advantage right now, because she's the only jammer, only person able to score points, and that's for Paris. And so her blockers can effectively just focus on offense.
So Paris is going to start this next jam with a power start, or they are the only person who will have a jammer. The forearm penalty that we saw Dos por Cuatro's pick up in that last jam is when you initiate contact with your arm, with your forearm, which you're not allowed to do.
And here we see a replay of the moment. Bisson managed to, gets around the hips of that Dos por Cuatro blocker. Incredible.
You know, there's only been one scoreless jam for Dos por Cuatro's in this game, while only two jams that Paris has been able to score in this game.
Oh, interesting. And it's Tamer who took the star and the power start. Really great way to capitalize on the offense that Paris was able to provide right away.
We do have the 2x4 jammer standing now coming back onto the track.
So the reason why the skaters are pushing each other or blocking each other is because they're trying to slow down that jammer or the skater with the star in their helmet. Because when they pass someone from the opposing team, they score a point, and that team doesn't want to be a point. So you're going to fight as hard as you can to not become a point, as people say in roller derby, or let that jammer pass you.
Exactly. And if that jammer does pass you, as we're seeing now, you're seeing the star on the skater in the white uniform, that's Paris, being drawn back. Now, that doesn't mean that she's going to automatically collect another point on you if she passes you again, because she hasn't left what we call the engagement zone, a.k.a. she hasn't gone to come and lap you again, basically. She's just kind of been knocked out and brought back. So that's another way that sometimes you'll see a jam last for 2 minutes, but perhaps the skater only picks up 4 points.
Yeah, and that's a way that the blockers can control the game, because we talk a lot about lead jammers and how lead jammers control the game because they have control of the clock, but blockers can have control of the field of play and therefore can shut down a jammer or cause a jammer to get too tired or to just be done or to give time for their jammer to start scoring points. Speaking of that, this is now a third jam where Paris is able to score points. They capitalized on that power start. They got 8 points. Score is now 28-87, and we have 5 minutes left in this half.
Okay, yeah, where did the half go? We are so happy, though, that you are with us today for this fantastic game live on Twitch. Like what you're seeing, well, join us for live free games from the 2019 postseason right here on Twitch. You can get the schedule of our free Twitch games at wftda.tv/Twitch.
And don't forget, if you like what you're seeing, you can join us here for free games from the 2019 postseason on Twitch. You can get the schedule of our free Twitch games at wftda.tv/Twitch.
All right, just quick, great mention of our skating officials, because right now there is a team timeout for 2x4. And the skating officials, just to mention, we talked about the refs, the jammer refs. Well, right now we're getting a quick replay there of the last jam. Incredible footwork by Paris. That was Tamer. You have the two jammer refs, so that's one for each team. You have inside pack refs, so those refs are dedicated solely to viewing what's happening between the blockers, watching for any penalties there from the inside of the track. And then you also have from the outside. And Tober, you can explain like the difference in the vantage points.
Yeah, so it's kind of hard. You definitely can't see the outside line from the inside because everybody has got bodies and height and whatever. But also the referees are keeping their eyes on to always cover every point and vantage point they can. So you'll see those outside pack refs skating backwards up front and then also in the middle and in the back in order to cover the full time. And they kind of will give each other some time to take a little bit of a break, whereas the inside pack refs are kind of covering that inside line, also looking for pack definition or where people are skating together.
Well, Tropical Mecánica is out with lead once more for 2x4. They have been really strong this first half. Paris, of course, as mentioned, has already skated in a full game this morning. It was a huge upset for Santa Cruz Roller Derby because they are the 5th seed of the tournament, falling to the 12th seeded Paris.
So Tropical Mecánica has been in 3 jams so far, has gotten lead all 3 times. It's 100% lead jam percentage. That's what you like when you're a jammer.
And for those saying this looks physically exhausting, it certainly is. These skaters are well-conditioned, have to do a bit of cross-training, of course, not to keep up your strength, but also your stamina, your cardio. These bursts of jams can seem really short, but wow, when you start adding them up between a half hour, it's it's a lot of time moving around and making sure you're in the right place with your body position to either provide that defense or the offense.
But 12 points already on the jam for Tropical Mecánica. And she just did a huge apex jump there up at the front. You can do that. You can jump out of bounds as long as you land in bounds and upright, and you get 4 more points for it. 16 points total on this jam so far. And we haven't talked a lot about the non-skating officials, but not only do you see these refs who are on skates covering the track, but there's a team of people not on skates who are making sure all of the penalties are recorded, the people are serving their penalties the right amount of time. We know we have a record of every single person who's played in every single jam. There are lineup trackers who do that. It's a very hard job. I've done it before. Mm-hmm. And then we also have scorekeepers and a scoreboard operator. So there's quite a bit of work going on this track to make sure every single piece of information is captured, everything is safe, and everyone is having fun.
Right now, we're going to go to a quick replay here. As you can see, the Dos Por Cuatro drammer is actually using the jersey of her teammate. You can certainly do that. The idea of Whip It comes from the movie Whip It. Is about whips and derby, and a lot of whips nowadays seem to be t-shirt whips or jersey whips, where you just grab your teammate and use that as sort of a launching point, a springboard to give you more momentum.
Yeah.
But I'm getting a little off track, so to speak. Tober, tell me a bit more about official reviews, because we're now in one.
Yeah, so every team gets one official review per half to start. You can ask the officiating crew to review a call, review a point scoring, review anything that could be happening on the track that you think they missed or did incorrectly. The official team will go off. They'll have a discussion. People who, you know, sometimes when you make a call, someone else has a different vantage point, so they kind of will have a huddle about what happened. And then they'll come back and let the team know what they've decided. Those official reviews, then if you get it right, you'll get it back. And if they decide that the no call or the call stands or whatever happens stands, you don't get it back. It seems like Parrish just used theirs as a timeout because it lasted for a minute and nobody talked to the captains, which you can also do that.
That makes sense. And that's why the little dot underneath Parrish's name has now disappeared. It means their official review for this half is done. It makes sense to use those breaks when you can get them. Rest your skaters as needed.
Yeah, each team gets three timeout, like regular plain old timeouts that don't replenish. That's for the whole game. And then they get one official review per half. And you can use that official review as a timeout if, let's say, it's the last 2 minutes of the game and you don't think you'll need to review something.
And right now we're in the thick of the pack, but Dos Por Cuatro, Lulazan, just finding it easy to keep that momentum. It's really tough when you're the jammer and you do come up against that strong wall and you just stop, because then it's you're starting from zero. You're having to push through with even more energy. Once again, a big thank you to everyone joining us right now on twitch.tv. You are watching WFTDA.tv. That's the Women's Flat Track Derby Association. And we also appreciate everybody answering questions for those who are joining us. You are watching Flat Track Roller Derby, which is different from Banked Track Roller Derby. And we are really glad that everyone's sort of answering each other's questions there. Once again, to remind you of who the voices from far are, I'm Death Nella, joined by October Revolution.
So what you see right there is a skater kind of, I like to say, dancing or spinning around a blocker to get that point and get out of the pack. It was a beautiful replay. If you haven't subscribed to our Twitch channel yet, click the subscribe button right above the video screen to get some seriously awesome perks, which include unique emotes, access to archives, and more. And I'll talk more about that in a little bit. We're going to go back to the action, though. Score is 115 to 28.
And right now we see the Dos Por Cuatro jammer getting caught up in the back of the pack. That's to the left of your screen right now. Just wedged between those skaters. And essentially what she's trying to do is create space. Well, in that case, drawing a penalty there on a Paris blocker. That was a multiplayer call. You're not allowed to simply, say, link arms, or sometimes it's not quite as obvious as that, but create an impenetrable link between skaters.
By grabbing. You can create an impenetrable link by pushing against your friend, which once you grab or link arms or anything like that, then it no longer becomes legal.
Yeah, basically anything that's going to, one way to describe it quite plainly is, if you need to break an arm to get through that link, well, it's definitely not legal. Because it is all about safety here in roller derby. This is why teams practice, and yes, a lot of them practice on what you're seeing right now, which is polished concrete. That is what the skaters are skating on.
The jammer now for Paris is Miss Godon. This has been a star pass, or the pivot takes the helmet cover of the jammer and becomes the jammer and has the ability to score. As you see, Miss Godon just picking up 4 points, scoring for Paris.
Miss Godon has been a phenomenal example of the versatility that skaters have in roller derby, where she blocks a lot, and blocked a lot in that first game, but also comes out and scores points as a jammer too. So it's all dependent on the position you take before heading into a jam. Here's a replay moment of the Dos Por Cuatro jammer saying, should I call it?
Yeah.
That's why the hands are up. And wow, we're at the half already. Dos Por Cuatro leading 119 to Paris 32. Now, for those just joining us, that's not a wash. We still have 30 more minutes of roller derby, and the way that those points tally up and change, it's still anyone's game.
Yeah, and also I think it's important to remember that the teams get some time to kind of adjust. I think that Paris, which has a very good like one-on-one blocker game, or like to slow jammers down, and the Dos Cuatro jammers have just been able to kind of cut around their defense for a lot of this game. So they're going to go back to the locker room, see if they can adjust and figure it out, and we're going to
have some fun. In fact, WFTDA Marketing has gone ahead and created a fun quiz to test our knowledge, but also your knowledge of the WFTDA Roller Derby. And of course, for those who are brand new, this is a great way to get to know some of the answers to the questions you've been asking on Twitch all game long. So let's take a look.
Let's go. You ready?
Yes, I am.
Let's do this.
We don't know the questions or the answers, so it's a multiple choice. Play along on Twitch. So how many people currently make up the WFTDA Board of Directors? Is it A7, B8, or C9? This is quite a difficult question.
Yeah, we're starting hard here.
I don't know the answer. I have my guess because...
I do too. I have a guess as well. I think I'll probably be wrong.
Okay. I'm going to guess B because 8 is my lucky number. So.
I'm going to go with A because 7 is my lucky number.
Okay, so we'll see.
We'll see.
It is C. Oh, goodness. I swear we did not plan that cheesy moment. It is C9. Okay. Board of Directors. Wow.
It's more like the Supreme Court then, apparently. Okay. Name the last WFTDA Championship event to have a themed name.
Oh, goodness. So was it A, Atlanta, Grits and Glory,
I know this
B,
one.
Denver, Continental Divide and Conquer, C, Chicago, Uproar on the Lakeshore, or D, there have never been names for tournaments?
I was at this tournament. I was a penalty box timer.
Oh, okay. Well, there. She's maybe eliminated one of the answers for you. We're seeing some people on the Twitch chat. Grits and Glory. You were there?
I was there. I timed penalties at the time. They were a minute long. It was a different day.
Do you remember roughly what year that was? Was it before the dinosaurs? Okay, we have a lightning round. How big is the outer officiating lane on a regulation track? Oh my gosh, Tober, you must know.
I do know. I do know this one. Oh, this is great. Keep up these. These are great for me.
All right, let's take a look. I don't know this. I've done an officiating workshop, but I'm not as great on the fly.
It's.
Oh my gosh, it's taking a while to get to the answer. We have about 30 seconds. Here we go.
Yeah, greater than or equal to 5 feet with a barrier or 10 feet without. Yeah, I was curious how they were going to answer that. That's complicating it. If you put 5, you're right, as long as you got like a padded wall, but you don't see a ton of those.
That officiating line is like the outer ring around it. Okay.
Who are the tournament head officials for the 2019 International WFTDA Championships? I'm embarrassed to say I don't remember. Do you remember?
I'm just smiling and nodding, but you can't see that, so...
I read the list when it came out. You can find the list at Tournament Central.
So you're really getting some inside information. Those just joining us on Twitch, this quiz is just for the halftime of a fantastic quarterfinal roller derby game. Okay, here's the answer.
Bambi Lance, the tournament head official, and Terabyte is the tournament head non-skating official.
Those are fantastic positions given to fantastic people. Here we go. We got a Jeopardy round of our WFTDA, that's the Women's Flat Track Derby Association, quiz. Ah, here we go. And I guess Tober she knows exactly what's going on here.
I was there for the very last one.
Disappeared from the rules in 2013 and changed the game forever.
I know this because I was there.
Anyone on the Twitch chat know the answer to this? I have a feeling I know what this is too. What are poodles?
Yeah, maybe. Maybe had something to do with poodles.
Oh, yes.
Yes. Minor penalties. I was there for I got to sign the whiteboard with the very last minor penalty on it. Because I'm clearly
can
very
you
old.
Just explain it in like 5 seconds?
It used to be that you could get like a quarter of a penalty. If you got 4, then you sat down.
And then you could time out when you would get your minor penalties. Okay. These are the only two U.S. cities to host the International WFTDA Championships twice.
This one's interesting.
I have my guesses, but I really don't know the answer to this. All I know is that this year marks the first time a non-U.S. city is hosting the WFTDA Championships, and that's Montreal, Quebec, Canada.
Speculate one was Portland.
Yes, I would. Yes. Portland and Philadelphia. There you go. Double H, our wonderful producer, who's sitting to our right, is from Philly, so of course Lots of pride there. Lots of love. Okay,
ooh,
true or
false?
All right, Tober, I'm going to let you ask these ones.
There are two WFTDA member leagues in South Africa. Is that true or false?
That is actually where I'm from. I'm from South Africa, so I am going to say true on that. I know for sure there's one because they have played at, they played in the World Cup recently in the WFTDA, or the female side.
Yeah.
So I'm going to say yes. I'm going to say true.
I think true is a good answer because it would be both surprising and believable, which is the perfect answer to true-false.
Come on, WFTDA quiz, I want to know. Yes,
yay.
There we go. Golden City Rollers and Cape Town Roller Girls. Cape Town is where I'm born and raised for a couple years before moving to Canada. So much love to the South African teams. So, true or false?
Mouth guards prevent concussions.
I'm going to go a hard false there.
Yeah, I don't think anything. False. I guess a helmet prevents concussion.
It may kind of, limit.
Limits. I guess prevent is a loaded
it's
word.
It's a sneaky word. It's a sneaky word. This tests our knowledge of concussions. All we know, though, for sure, is that the WFTDA takes concussion protocol and concussions very seriously.
False. So for the protection of mouth guard during impact, the likelihood of jaw dislodgement or neck trauma is reduced. The jaw dislodgement just made me cringe.
And with that, we are going to
wear your mouth
finish
guard.
Up the WFTDA quiz. Thank you for following along. Twitch chat, you have been an absolute blast.
Yeah.
We're loving the input. Keep going.
Yeah, we have an upcoming raffle, so make sure you register for Twitch so you can join us in the chat and enter that raffle. And we're going to throw it over to Sissy Splasek, who's trackside with Denver's Lady Trample. Sissy, take it away.
Hey, Sissy Splasek. Let's do this. Here with Lady Trample from Denver. Hello.
Hi. Thanks for having me.
So you're here in town doing Chicks and Bulls. And what does that mean? Tell everybody. These people are at home on Twitch. They don't know what that means.
So we've got the post-playoffs trade sessions taking place this weekend. We have one this weekend and one next weekend in Seattle. We're going to be having basically a three-hour session at the skate park. We have booked out the entire place thanks to Wftda. And we will be having myself and Bambi Bloodlust this weekend. And next weekend, it's going to be myself and Kid Ace. And we're going to be running some beginner and advanced skating sessions, basically teaching some drop-ins, pumping, stalls, basically whatever the groups are wanting to learn, and helping spread the stoke.
That's super exciting. I have only had the teeniest experience of bowl skating. Took my mom.
Oh, what? Awesome.
We're trying to teach her how to skate, and we were both like, just the tiniest little dip into the bowl. It was really fun, but it was terrifying.
It is terrifying, and I think that's something that I like to try and help people work through is that initial stage. In roller derby, we have fresh meat. We have that opportunity to kind of dip our toes, as you were saying, alongside other people that are learning. And for roller skaters in the skate park, we didn't really typically have that. It's kind of like go in and try not to hurt yourself. So one of the things that we're going to be trying to do this weekend is showing people how to safely learn to park skate so that they can then go and take it to their local skate park and, you know, shred the gnar.
And be super cool out there. So this is a pretty busy season for you besides roller derby, obviously, and playing, of course, in playoffs next week. You're also preparing for the biggest game of your life, which you guys have named Altercation.
Yeah.
Tell me what this means.
So I can't take credit for the pun. The pun is 1,000% score legal. Altercation at Elevation is taking place in Gunnison, which is her hometown, which is very high in elevation. And it's actually the same weekend we're getting married. So we are going to be fighting for last names because we couldn't choose. And it wasn't, you know, I don't know, not that we would go by that anyway, but it's not like there was a natural path of like, well, I take yours or you take mine. And she suggested having a game. And then I was like, well, what are we going to fight for? And along the way, we basically came to realize that we wanted to fight over last names and we wanted our friends to help us do that.
That's amazing. So this is your one chance in front of the whole internet to get people to your side for your name. What do you want to tell everybody?
I mean, the Pepperell Lion may die with me. I have a brother. Hi, Jordan, if you're listening. But neither of us are likely to have kids. And so my poor family lion, the Pepperell family bloodline, that name might not continue if you guys don't support me. So I just want to, you know, like send that little sad story out there. Team Pepperell for the win. Plus, it's a cool name. I mean, it's spicy. It's fun to say. It's got lots of P's and lots of L's. I mean, I don't even know how to spell Viscovic. So come on, do me a favor.
You heard that heartwarming plea here first. And you know what to do, internet. You know what to do. All right, that's all. Let's see some more roller derby.
Yeah.
I'm Sissy's Place. Like, this is Lady Trample. Thanks, y'all.
Now we're going to run a raffle for a watch pass for this weekend's Cup, the 2019 International WFTDA Playoffs on WFTDA.tv.
This is only game five that you're watching, so you have two more full days of derby that you can only catch with the watch pass. And as I mentioned before, the watch pass gives you so much flexibility. Games are archived. You're able to pause and play and do everything that you need to do on demand. So it's really handy, especially if you want to get to know a lot more about roller derby.
Listen, this is how you can enter now. Use the command Winston in the chat. That's exclamation point Winston, W-I-N-S-T-O-N. And we'll keep the opportunity open for 2 minutes. So go. You got 2 minutes.
Right now, command if you're on Winston. That Twitch chat, type in Winston and you are going to be entered for that raffle.
And you can get all of the games this weekend. So if you're having fun, you can keep having fun. And so we mentioned during our last Cup broadcast that we have some exciting news about championships.
We do, because we're excited to offer Team Indigenous and Jewish Roller Derby a platform to showcase We Are Nation, a game without borders. Now that will stream free on WFTDA.tv. Saturday, November 16th. So for those with physical calendars, mark it or put it in your phone right now. That's coming at you live from Montreal. Now, these are two teams without borders who continue to challenge all of us in the WFTDA to do better. We acknowledge their hard work and hope to share these amazing teams with as many viewers as possible. I'm going to use the example of Team Indigenous. They're made up from skaters of Indigenous backgrounds from around the world. It is so beautiful to see. And of course, it's roller derby, so it's always fun too. And getting to bring those teams together and give them that platform is going to be fantastic.
Yeah, roller derby is an international sport, as you can tell from this game, where we have Dos por Cuatro's roller derby from Buenos Aires, Argentina, playing Paris Roller Girls from Paris, France. And the score coming out of the half is 119-32. The real story of this game here is Paris had an unbelievable upset in the morning, but it was a very physical and hard game that they've played. And because of that, you know, they're coming into this game a little bit less fresh than Dos por Cuatro's, who had a bye because they came in at a higher seed.
Yes, they started here at this first quarterfinal of the tournament.
This is their first game. They've had the whole morning to relax. So, you know, they're ready to go. And also, I would say another thing to talk about is that Dos por Cuatro has been able to so seamlessly shift from offense to defense, or blocking those jammers and getting their jammer out, that really Paris hasn't been able to use their one-on-one blocking or even their pack blocking as much, because they're just kind of constantly being jostled up by the very quick Dos por Cuatro.
We're loving everyone's entries in the raffle there, so keep going. At least for a little bit. We will let you know when that has closed. As well, talking about international, the WFTDA, that's the Women's Flat Track Derby Association, has 460 leagues spanning six continents. I know we talked about Antarctica before, of course, being the seventh that doesn't have derby yet, but you never know, right? When derby has a will, it certainly finds a way.
Think about what kind of wheels you would need on ice, though.
Ice skates?
Like a one. They need to be rated a one. Very few people get the joke I'm making, so I will stop making it. Jamming right now for Dos por Cuatro, that is Tropical Mechanica, up against Tamir from Paris.
And just a reminder, those voices that you're hearing on your broadcast, well, I'm Death Nella, joined by October Revolution, and we are so happy you're joining us wherever you are around the world right now. You are watching WFTDA.tv live on Twitch.tv.
Looks like Papaya, the rest of your name I didn't see because it scrolled by too fast, won, so congratulations, enjoy your watch pass. And there you go.
And if you can't get all to that derby all weekend, well, it's there for you whenever you need it.
4 points to start this half by Dos por Cuatro's, 123-32. If you're just joining us and you don't know what's going on, don't worry. We're going to break this game down jam by jam as we're watching it. If you're watching and you do know what's going on, don't worry. We'll also do analysis that you love jam by jam as you're watching it.
Yeah, or join the Twitch chat and help folks who are trying to figure out this game, because it is something that you really have to experience and take in, and it's a lot at first, but then, wow, is it fun when you start breaking it all down. And here we go. We have your jammers. Those are the point scorers with the stars on their helmets. Lulazan and Star with the star. I've said that a number of times today, Star being one of the prominent jammers for Paris.
So the jammer, or the person with the star on their helmet, as you were just saying, is the only one who could score points on the track. They score points for each blocker that they pass upright and in bounds. We've got two blockers ahead of the penalty box. We haven't even discussed kind of penalty box points. So when there's someone sitting in the penalty box and your jammer passes one single person from the other team, they get points for everyone in the box and the person that they did. So right now you've got two in the box, or dos por cuatro. So that Parrish jammer only needs to pass one person to get 3 points. So being in the penalty box is a big disadvantage. Not only are you not on the track to block, but also you're just a free point.
I know, I definitely, that was one of my first questions when I started roller derby. Hey, is it an advantage to be in the box? Do I get to save my point? No, you don't. You're giving it up for free, basically.
Yeah, and like when you are a blocker, your job is to not be a point and to keep your friends from being points. And when you're a jammer, your job is to make everybody points.
All right, and right now the pack, it seems, I'm going to use the word squirrely to describe it, but it's it's actually very strategic. It's organized chaos, if you will, because the blockers are positioning themselves in a way. Of course, they are allowed to contact other skaters. There are legal blocking and target zones, however. And that's what comes into play when we talk about penalties, which we will get into at the end of this jam, because some skaters out there are sitting about 4 penalties. The maximum you can get is 7, and well, that 7th one sends you out of the game.
So up there at the front, you saw Bully Bunker knocking out Lulazon and bringing her all the way back. What you want to do as a blocker a lot of the time is get those jammers out of bounds. When you get them out of bounds, you can slow them down and also move them back on the track, because they have to come in behind you when you knock them out, as long as you don't step out of bounds or fall down. So you'll see those blockers take the jammer all the way to the line and then do all that extra work to get them over the line, because that way they can keep them from scoring more points. Because even if they're on a scoring pass, like Lulazon was there, you can't score more points if you don't get out to lap again. So
exactly, and that's actually why there's a bit of a difference in language. Like, a scoring pass is that initial time when you clock the point, but a trip through the pack indicates each different time you are going on your scoring passes. So I know that might seem like a lot to follow, just me saying verbally, but essentially if you can't escape the pack or get out of that engagement zone, you're just going to keep getting swallowed up and getting no additional points. And wow, Paris with lead jammer status. Bisson, that has not been something in Paris's favor this game very much, so this is huge for Paris.
4 leads total on the game for Paris. This is a big deal. They have control of the clock for the first time in this half, and only the 4th time in the game. It's 4 unanswered points so far for Paris. And for those of you who don't know, the points, not only does the winner matter, but the point spread matters, because the ranking system in the WFTDA is mathy. And just trust me when I say,
really great description.
The spread of points, it's mathy. It's mathy. Just there's a formula. It's delightful. If you like math, get real into it. But just so you know, the point spread matters.
And here we see a replay moment. Oh, Bisson just staying on the toe stops there on the inside line. Oh, plenty of room. I say just on the inside line. Plenty of room for Bisson. Another great resource as well, this Twitch chat. It's been wonderful to see people sharing links and resources. But if you're on Twitter as well, hashtag Derby Twitter, you can ask questions literally any time of the day, and someone somewhere in the world will answer them, because that's what Derby's all about. We want to grow the game, grow the sport, and get more people involved. So you can find WFTDA on all social media, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at WFTDA.
This is Louisette Bonbon going to the box on a track cut. She was trying to kind of tiptoe through on that inside line, as you see a lot of those jammers do, trying to get by the blockers who are guarding the line. Stepped out of bounds with like one wheel, but that's all it takes. Didn't yield, and is sitting in the box for 30 seconds. This is a power jam now for Loba and Dos Por Cuatro.
And it looks like Dos Por Cuatro hasn't even made it through their initial pass. Now, that's something we also haven't touched on, but that very first time you're trying to get out of the pack, you can't score points. That's just sort of a way to establish whether you get lead status or not.
But that's a big, big deal, as we've been talking about. Those of you who are new and don't know, having lead status means you can call a jam off, which means you can keep the other jammer from scoring, or keep the other jammer in the box, or if your wheel falls off, you can say, nope, we're done. So, you know.
Yes, there's a number of reasons for calling off a jam. And there we have Louisette Bonbon out on her initial, rather. My apologies. So she hadn't completed her initial either, but she can't get lead because she was sent to the penalty box. So now just basically just trying to collect as many points in the last 28 seconds of this jam.
We have what we call, that's a brace three wall in the front that those Torquatos, who's wearing black, is executing. Basically, they have one person in the front directing the other three blockers to hold back that jammer. Jammer was able to kind of recycle back, break apart that three wall as this pack sped up. And
the pack, something we talk about a lot, it's basically just the sum of all the blockers on the track. So that includes your team and the other team, because guess what? You got to weave through all those bodies, whether they're on your side or not, and that can be sometimes a very big challenge as well. So that's why Derby on the track, we're seeing it at a really great vantage point, but when you're actually on the level of being flat out there, it's a maze. And here we go, we see that's some great footwork, but that was the moment, I believe, the cut track on Louisette Bonbon from Paris in the white there.
Yep, one step out, so you got get that. You got both your whole body over the line, your feet and your butt, and you're able to block those jammers.
And that is Tamer out for Paris. Paris's pivot, that's the skater with the stripe, the helmet cover stripe, is sitting in the penalty box.
Tropical Mechanica is one of two jammers in Dos Pocuatro who has 100% lead on the day. That's a big deal.
Yes, and that's why where you see the point spreads as well. It really is most often a reflection of your ability to get lead jammer status in a game.
Yeah, I think it's 17 leads for Dos Pocuatro and only 4 for Paris. And I want to thank you to our Twitch audience. Thank you for helping each other out, for staying with us, for learning about the game. Hope you're having fun. Don't forget that this is September, meaning first-time Twitch subscribers can purchase a Tier 1 sub to Wftda for 50% off, meaning for $2.49, you can get a month of access to the archives.
And hey, if perhaps you're not quite ready for that yet, there's still a chance to win a watch pass at the end of this bout, so stay here. Wow, and also a jammer penalty being called. I believe that was a low block?
Yes.
Assessed to Tropical Mechanica, so that means no lead jammer status. Of course, you lose that when you go to the penalty box, so it'll run to its natural conclusion here.
Yeah, natural conclusion is another 37 seconds. You can see the jam clock is kind of underneath the little pink period clock. Score is 136-46.
Ah, and you can almost see Tamer's stars starting to come off her helmet a little bit. Now, if you don't have a star on your head, you are not able to, even if you are the jammer, collect points. So that's why you need to keep it on your head. You have to be highly visible. You can't just be sneaky, right? Because otherwise why don't we take that off and try to blend in with all the blockers? Well, you can, but you're not going to score any points. Another way that I like to describe a jammer is that you're a blocker with the privilege of scoring points. Yeah. Of course, blockers don't have that privilege, and that's why the jammer is a special position, and there's only two on the track.
Okay. Here's a replay that's an apex jump. Both feet in, but then the low block there when Tropical Mechanica stumbled, fell forward, took a hit, which was legal, but then fell forward and knocked that skater in front of her down. We're seeing an official review being called by Paris. Remember, you get one per half. And
so right now in the cluster in the middle of the track there, that would be your captains and your coaches speaking with the head referee there. That's Razor.
And right now you're able to make your case, so whatever your case could be, you get to kind of talk it out, make your case, and then the referees will go away from you, they'll skate away, or walk away, whether or not they're both on skates or no skates, they'll go skate away, pull over who they need, you know, and maybe you need the penalty box timer, maybe you need the scorekeeper, you go get some people, have a chat.
Exactly.
And
have
you come back and say, this is what we determined.
And while we can see, obviously, the video feed, there is no video replay in Derby for officials, so a lot of it is trusting one another, having a really strong crew, and going through what each person saw. Yeah. And that's why having those 7 officials out there, whether it's the jammer ref, the inside pack ref, outside pack ref, your head referee, of course, who's kind of overseeing the whole thing, it is wild. And if you're a skater in Derby and you've never tried officiating, please do that. Even if it's just one workshop, just to know and respect the work that goes into being a skating official.
And also just understand what they actually see and all their different vantage points. But the skating officials do a lot of work to make sure they can kind of see every angle at a time. And then also in these official reviews, you'll see them pull in either the head NSO or other NSOs, depending if, you know, you might need a lineup tracker if you're debating who's on the track and who should be on the track. You might need a penalty timer.
There we go.
Okay. Team White have requested an official review. They are asking a review of the call on Blackjammer26. That was called as a low block, and they're requesting that to be reviewed as a possible expulsion.
Okay. So we have actually seen an expulsion already this tournament, which was somewhat, it's always that surprising because it doesn't happen very often.
Yeah, it was Santa Cruz. It was during the Paris game, but that was for avoidable contact with an official.
Yes.
This is, they're asking, they're saying that, was that jump egregious enough? Was that low block and that jump egregious enough that it isn't just the 1 minute, the 30-second penalty, but it's also expulsion worthy?
Yes, because of course you do need to be in control of your body, and that's why becoming a derby skater, you have to meet minimum benchmarks. You can't just simply decide I'm going to go play at this level without meeting those minimum skills. That was an interesting landing there. Now, of course, the officials are going to go over, you know, was it incidental? Was it because of the hit on the jammer? You know, that contact there, how can you foresee that? So we'll get the answer from our head ref. Yeah. But that's the sort of questioning that's going through their minds. And that's why you have to respect the officials. They are the ones having to talk through these really big moments within games.
Yeah, and also, you know, they're going to have a discussion about egregiousness and how unsafe something is, because it is the official's number one job is to keep everybody safe and healthy. And here we go, back to Razor the head.
On review, the officials have rechecked the call made on Black 26 for a low block after an apex jump. On review, we still feel that the call was correct. The call will stand. Black 26 has served, and the game will continue. Thank you.
Okay, so Black 26, that's Tropical Mechanica, will stay in play. And maintaining a 100% lead percentage, might I add.
This means that Paris will not keep their official review. So their official review is done for this half. They've used it. If they had gotten an expulsion out of that official review, they would have gotten it back. They could use it a second time, but they cannot now. So they've only got their two clock stoppages left, which are timeouts.
And those are very important as we near the end of the game. We'll possibly talk about that later on. So right now we're in play. We have Star with the Star for Paris and Lulazan for Dos por Cuatro. These teams, reminder, Dos por Cuatro is from Buenos Aires, Argentina, and Paris, well, from Paris, France. Now I'm seeing lots of discussion on the Twitch chat about points and high scoring points. For those who have maybe watched Derby in the past, just a reminder that this year is the first year that teams aren't going to be scoring 5 points if, say, they lap the jammer. That used to be an extra point. The maximum you can score now is 4. And that's what we're seeing from these teams as the other team, or their blockers rather, are effectively holding that opposing jammer. Dos por Cuatro once again with control of the jam, having lead jammer status.
Made 4 points up on the board for Dos por Cuatro, 144 now for them, 49 for Paris.
The other thing that you likely can't hear, I don't know if the mics are picking it up, but there's always lots of communication in Derby. So I know we're talking a lot and explaining it, and that's great, but on the track, these skaters are talking to one another and positioning themselves exactly where they need to be. And that is one of the great things about Derby, because you have that physical proximity to your teammates. You can have those discussions as the game's playing out.
Well, it's interesting because teams who have been together for a long time will either develop hand signals or they'll just kind of tap each other. And you can kind of see there's a lot of communication going on that's not necessarily all verbal. There's also a lot of body language communication. It's a very close sport. You become very close with your team as you're playing. And I keep talking about this. I'm going to call it The Bad Place because I love that show. So you can see that is Lulazan caught in that brace two wall, just unable to get free. And that's The Bad Place. When you're in that spot as a jammer, you just go, I am in the bad place.
Stuck in the mud. And then sometimes as a jammer, you get a mentality like, no, I'm good here. I'm going to keep pushing. I'm going to keep trying to fight my way through. But wow, you get stuck more. And here we see a replay. Gorgeous footwork there by Dos por Cuatro's jammer, able to stay on that 1 foot. And this is the high level roller derby we're talking about. I mean, these teams, Dos por Cuatro is 12th in the world, and they're here.
Paris is 27th in the world.
Yes.
So, you know, you might see a big differential here, but remember, there's hundreds of teams that Paris is ranked above. This is just the highest level kind of this sport is playoffs and then champs.
Yeah, the top three teams out of this tournament, which ends Sunday, they're going on to the WFTDA International Championships, happening in Montreal, Canada, November 15th to the 17th.
So the penalty box is full for Dos Pro Cuatro, and one of their blockers on the track right now is waiting to serve a penalty. So that means they've only got kind of two to go. When one of the players stands up in the box, that person who's waiting to serve a penalty will go sit down. Jammer penalty, that's Besson sitting down for Harris. I think it was a high block.
And Dos Pro Cuatro with lead jammer status. Notice the inside pack ref pointing. That's an indication that that skater has lead, actually physically pointing at that skater, keeping track of where she is. Rashu for Dos Pro Cuatro skating on by with four more points.
Yeah, sometimes the jammers just outrun the defense. Like, as the defense is trying to form around them, they're just like, whoop, I'm gone.
And there really is no one way to jam. Some jammers are incredibly fast, which is can be very handy. Others are powerful, and they can just use their strength to basically bulldoze through. Sometimes you get the mix of both. Others, and height, too. That's what I love about derby, is there's no one perfect fit. Everyone's got their strengths, and they're able to use that in various positions, from blocking to jamming.
Yeah, this we have a replay going on right here.
Yeah, there's an example. Look at those skaters
holding on but hopping out
and taking the line for Dos Por Cuatro is Luba and Louisette Bonbon for Paris. And this game is just moving on. This is the first quarterfinal of the WFTDA International Playoff here in Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
Loba picks up lead for Dos Pro Cuatro, now has control of the clock.
We are live right now, so wherever you're joining us, welcome. You are watching this game as it's happening. Very exciting stuff. We appreciate your chats and your discussion.
And you can get the schedule of the rest of our free games from the 2019 postseason right here on Twitch. You can go to wftda.tv/Twitch.
And we're seeing a little bit of penalty box interchange, blockers sitting in and out. We do have some skaters sitting at five penalties apiece. There's two on Dos Por Cuatro, one for Paris. Once they hit that seventh, they are out. They are fouled out. So five, you're getting in a bit of a danger zone. I have seen some skaters, though, start the half with six penalties and stay that way for the entire game. So, hey.
Yeah, you stop taking risks when you're sitting at six.
Yes, you do. You play a little bit safer, a little bit cleaner. And right now we're seeing Louisette Bonbon just getting caught up on those two Dos Por Cuatro blockers. But a forearm call on Loba, I believe. Is sending her
no
it was never
a blocker,
mind
yeah.
My apologies, that was a blocker penalty there.
It's gonna be 4 points on the board for Paris in that jam. Eight though for Dos Pro Cuatro's score is now 163-53. This is about on track. The last time these two teams played, it was 182-78 was the final score, so we're like almost exactly tracking that.
Okay, stick around, Twitch folks, because after this game, we're giving away one more WFTDA.TV 2019 Hydra Bundle. Ooh. To see every game from Playoffs and Champs. Oh my gosh, this is valued at $55, and one Winston-Salem Watch Pass will be coming your way for the rest of this weekend, which is valued at $17. So if you want to enter, stick around, we'll tell you how, and you stand a chance to win.
Okay, so jamming right now, we have Tamer and Tropical Mechanica. The jammers are the people you see with the stars in her helmet. They score points. The one having a finger pointed at them, that is the jammer. She is the lead jammer, and she is now in control. She can call off the jam or end it. So if you see the little clock in the black box, that's the jam clock, and the clock in the pink box is the period clock.
And Paris is showing us, or showed us rather, a gorgeous successful star pass. That is when the jammer has transferred that privilege of scoring points over to the pivot, the only other skater who can take on that role. It's the one with the stripe, you see her there. But this is a replay now showing the moment where the Dos Por Cuatro jammer is able to stay in bounds. Wow, Paris has had a really tough time bringing the Dos Por Cuatro skaters to the line and out of bounds, so that they're not able to simply stay there and just skirt on by.
breaking through the middle lead. Jammer going to Lulazon. In the back there, you see Dos Por Cuatro trying to hold back Star with that race wall. Now, Paris is race wall getting knocked aside, basically, by the blockers from Dos Por Cuatro.
And right now, Paris as well has been struggling with penalties. In total, they've had 30 penalties this game, 11 already in this half. Although Dos Por Cuatro, they're sitting at 23 total, 13 this half. So penalty troubles on both sides. And some teams are able to recover okay with that because they have really strong two-person and one-person blocking. Here we have another replay of that Dos Por Cuatro jammer. That is a shot right down the straightaway to start the game. And that's where we're seeing it very successful.
Again, thank you to our Twitch audience. Thanks so much for engaging with us today and joining us here at the WFTDA for our international playoffs.
And right now the game is in play. People are moving around, trying to figure out, jockeying once again for position. As blockers, you do always want to move back because you're trying to conserve space. You don't want to just relent necessarily so that Jammer can get out. But wow, oh my goodness, right as Paris was able to secure lead Jammer status, Bisson given a track cut penalty. That means she had stepped out of bounds somehow and then re-entered in an illegal position.
I think that track cut came from the outside, which means that lead might still be available because it could have been that it was awarded erroneously. Yes, that is correct. So lead does go to Rachel. So basically what that means is that the jammer ref, the ref who was assigned to the jammer, thought that she had gotten through clean and upright, but the outside pack ref was like, no, I saw it. She stepped out of bounds on the outside, and that's why we have this power jam that has just ended because Bisson is headed back into the action.
And Bisson has taken the star off her helmet, and in doing so, can create confusion as to whether, is Bisson going to do a star pass, or is she going to sneak around and get through and keep trying to collect points? Meanwhile, the Dos Por Cuatro skaters are going to the penalty box here. I believe it was for a multiplayer call.
Yeah, so I think two important things about this, right? We have a very big differential. It's very unlikely that Epis can come back here. But every point they score is important for ranking. So that's why you see both teams still fighting real, real hard at this game, and they will all the way to the end. And the other thing is this penalty issue that you see Dos Por Cuatro having, they're only at 24. It's not a lot, but it's three players that have a majority of those penalties. They're going to want to watch that when they're playing the higher seeded game.
And it's a good time for Paris to take a timeout. Meanwhile, we're going to flip to this replay real quick. There's that moment, Bisson. You can see it on the left. Did step outside, thought she was safe, but wasn't. And that's where that track cut was called. The other thing I wanted to mention is we do have a skater who has fouled out from Paris. That's Charlie. We haven't really been able to talk about her much, but Charlie is one of those skaters. She's right in the thick of the pack. That's possibly why we don't always get a chance to see her number and her name and call it. But this morning especially, just such a formidable skater and really tough to get by, was definitely a key point, I guess. That's not the word I'm looking for. Very important, though, in securing that win this morning.
And I will say Paris is up to 35 penalties on this game. That is higher than they were this morning. I think, part of that could be they played this morning, so you're a little bit more tired. You have a little less control over where you are in space. But then also I think Dos Por Cuatro is doing a very good job of drawing penalties, especially direction of play penalties. So as Paris is trying to recycle or get back, Dos Por Cuatro is putting their blockers in the way, so they're contacting them as they're trying to skate backwards, and they're just calling penalty after penalty. So that is great. So Paris only had one lead jammer status this half.
Wow.
I think that's four overall. So they really have been out of control of the clock and the game, and that makes it so you can't kind of stop the bleeding.
It also makes those 57 points they have, in my opinion, almost more valuable to think that those were scored with such limited control of the clock.
Especially because when you are the team that's in charge of a game like that, you can really kind of dominate and hold the team scoreless repeatedly, repeatedly, repeatedly. And the Paris is able to kind of get almost 60 points on this game so that they're able to kind of keep their jammers right coming out of the pack afterwards. We're not seeing a lot of huge multi-pass jams over and over and over again.
Yeah, that's why we're not seeing Twitch users. Those on the chat have noticed that. You're not seeing these 20, 30-point jams. Here we go. We have Loba out for 2x4 and Tamer for Paris. And it is 2x4 out with lead. They're able to as well, Tober, really execute their lead jammer status almost immediately. That momentum.
Yeah.
Just so, right out of the gate.
So what you just saw was basically like a textbook roller derby jam, right? Mm-hmm. One jammer gets out right away, gets lead right away, skates around pretty fast. The other jammer gets out, so the first one just scores 4 points, calls out that jam before the other one can score, and then we reset and take 30 seconds off the clock. And here in the replay,
yeah, because
we
right
see
now
that going out. You see, this is the
there's that
quick
moment.
Lead, and then yep, we just score 4 points, call it off. That's kind of like, if I was going to teach you how to play roller derby, that would be like the first thing I would teach you.
And it makes sense. Instead of just trying to collect the most points, you want to protect your points as well, because of course 2x4 wants to create that bigger gap to kind of keep their rankings where they need to. They'll likely win in terms of winning the game, but it's winning the point spread as well. We also just want to say thank you for joining our Twitch stream today. If you want to see more excellent roller derby, visit wftda.tv/watchpass. Find out how you can catch the rest of this event and many more in the WFTDA postseason.
Tropical Mechanica able to keep that 100% lead percentage. Is lead pushing through that brace too while at the back. Paris desperately trying to keep it together, although able to take one of their players and stick her up for offense in the front, trying to get their skater out.
2x4 losing a skater to the penalty box, a blocker. As we mentioned before, if you have a blocker in the box and that other jammer is in scoring position, they just need to pass one blocker inbounds to collect not only that point, but also the point that's in the penalty box. And the 2x4 Tropical Mechanica is getting in a bit of trouble there, getting in a sticky spot with the Paris wall.
So underneath, I see somebody asking, what are those zeros underneath the score? That's the jam score. So you can see how many points each jammer has scored for this jam, and then the overall points for the game. So Paris just scored 4 points. So you can see that underneath, and it's 61 for the game so far.
Yeah, and notice how she did a complete lap, and now she's able to start scoring again a maximum of 4 before exiting and coming back again for more. Or, in this case, coming to the end of that jam. We have less than 6.5 minutes left on the game clock. Now, that does not mean that that's the amount of total derby left, because we'll talk about jam clock versus game clock in a second. Look at that fantastic spin work by Star.
Yeah,
Paris.
You
wow.
see that? You see blockers do that a lot, where they kind of skate backwards towards the line in hopes of stopping that jammer. Often, though, the jammer sees it coming and just kind of puts on the gas and is able to get through like that and get that agility. They can kind of like whoop. So let's say right around. Yeah,
exactly. Whoop. That's what it is. And just to be able to keep your awareness on the track is what these skaters are showing. They make it look so easy. I mean, you're watching high level roller derby. And right now we have Lulazan out for 2x4 being told to call it off. Did Paris make out with some points? No,
nope.
They didn't.
2 for 2x4, 0 for Paris. That's a huge win for Paris. Only 2 points on that jam. Hasn't been a ton of jams today where they've held them underneath at least a full 4.
And here we have another look right down the straightaway. Wow, 2x4 with the powerhouse on the inside lane. They've been able to really maximize that. And when Paris looks back at this footage, I mean, that's what this is used for too, is game review. They're going to have to really work on covering that inside line and making it a little bit more difficult for these teams to quickly take advantage of lead jammer status. Oh,
and
wow.
Lead goes to Paris. That is Tamer with lead.
That was so quick, right as I'm talking about taking the inside lane. Hey, Tamer must have heard that, because she was right there, did a quick apex jump as well to accelerate that, now in perfect position to score some points for Paris.
It's so important when you're covering the lines, you're inside or outside, you don't just have your feet there, but you actually put your body over the line, because jammers can literally step in between your feet if you're not making it impossible for their body to get around. There's a cut now being called on Reisha, who is going to the penalty box. It's going to be now a power jam for Paris. So they are in control and the only team that can score.
So this is an advantage for Paris because their blockers, as you can see right now, the white blockers are providing a bit of an offensive assist. However, that also means that Dos por Cuatro can just focus on defense. So it's a little bit of an advantage in a number of ways. Of course, Dos por Cuatro can't get any points because their jammers, well, now standing in the box, which means less than 10 seconds left on that penalty.
It's a good visual cue for the teams. Like, oh, that jammer's standing there. I've got 10 seconds.
And coaches are allowed to yell on the track, hey, jammer standing. They're allowed to communicate with their team what's happening. And
you'll often see somebody from a team sitting in what we call turn three. And if you start counting kind of from the lines, you see these little, like, the long lines that go all the way across. That's turn one, two, three. You'll see sometimes somebody standing or sitting at turn three to tell the teams when they can't see the bench what to do. 3 points on that jam for Paris, 2 for Dos por Cuatro. It's 192-64, and we have just 3 minutes.
Oh, wow. And look at that moment there where Tamer is just able to stay. Ooh, a nice little hop, avoiding that hip butt combo, trying to wipe you out to the line there.
Yeah, the swish out to the line. It's kind of like a last ditch effort. And usually when that jammer can see you, especially when they have legs like Tamer, who's like really leggy and could just jump over you.
And you're totally right about a last-ditch effort. Derby has evolved in such a way that that sort of sideswipe action is no longer very useful because you don't have as much control over your body to position yourself in a way to block. And we do have an official timeout where I want to quickly say that the Women's Flat Track Derby Association is the international governing body of roller derby. Find out more about how to play, where to play, because guess what? There's likely a league near you, and about our over 460 member leagues at wftda.com/new.
If you're enjoying what you're seeing, don't forget that it's September, meaning first-time Twitch subscribers can purchase a Tier 1 sub to WFTDA for 50% off. That's $249. You can get a month of access to the archives of the 2019 postseason available here on Twitch. If you have Amazon Prime, you can use your free Twitch Prime with
WFTDA. I'm going to do that.
I'm going to do that.
I do have an Amazon Prime account.
But this is not free sub here with us.
This is not a plug for Amazon. This is a plug for WFTDA because the work that's going on here is done by a lot of volunteers as well. A big thank you to everyone involved, and a big thank you to the host league for this playoffs. That's Greensboro Roller Derby, by the way. And I see Tober pointing at something.
I think Avocado is going to foul out or has fouled out. There's 7 on the board, but there's no foul out indicator yet.
That is the Parisian skater Avocado. And, of course, Paris roster v. Dos por Cuatro roster, they were actually pretty even keel in terms of numbers, I think. Same amount of skaters, actually, on each team. Both teams having to travel here to Winston-Salem, North Carolina, for this playoff.
Start is sitting in the penalty box for Paris. It's a power jam for Dos por Cuatro. Did you just say that?
No, I didn't.
Okay,
so
good.
Thank you for picking up on that, Tober. I know. There's a lot of talking going on, so I appreciate it. And here we have Loba coming back now, ready to score some more points, rather, for Dos por Cuatro, already with 4 points from that first scoring trip through the pack.
And yes, there's been 2 foul outs so far, 41 penalties for Paris and 30 for Dos por Cuatro, so a heavy penalty game.
And you were correct about that. Our penalty board has now been reflected to show that Avocado from Paris Roller Girls has indeed fouled out of this quarterfinal. Managed to stay in quite a while, though. There's just over a minute left in the final half of this game.
We had a loose toe stop, but it's gone now.
And, of course, a toe stop is essentially just one way to stop on the track. You are allowed to skate without them if you so choose. They have become quite important in flat track roller derby because it's a way to quickly gain momentum or stop as well very quickly.
So it gives you a little bit of extra agility when you want to get in those teeny tiny spaces. Being up on your toe stops means you won't roll into the wrong space.
Just like we saw Loba do, ending up on the one hand, slightly out of bounds, but that's still upright. You're still
one
good.
Hand.
Yeah,
fine.
One hand.
You need more than one hand. Out of bounds.
Another Paris skater to the penalty box.
Paris putting together a beautiful defense in the back here. You'll see a lot of these braced walls because you really are able to slow those jammers down, get them stuck, and grind them to a halt. And that's what Paris did force. I don't know if it was called, but the jam just ended. But it's 12 points total for Dos por Cuatro. 204 now to 64 for Paris. So scores open wide.
And here we see a replay. As you talked about, that Paris wall,
yeah,
very strong, but Dos por Cuatro's blockers opening up the lane there for Loba. We have an unofficial
final. We're over. It ended.
We barely had time to realize that the jammer clock and the period clock both came to a natural end there. And it's unofficial right now until we hear the whistle blow, but we have Dos por Cuatro with 204 points. Interesting matching of numbers there, 204, Dos por Cuatro, versus Paris's 64 points. I know, that's just my weird brain.
So this
brain.
Is a bigger differential win than the last time these teams met over a year ago. I think playing into that is the penalty count. There was 2 foul outs for Paris, 42 penalties. That's, 21 minutes where people could only be points and couldn't block or help. So that's a lot of time to have, you know, an ineffective blocker. 31 penalties for Dos por Cuatro, though. They're going to need to tighten that up if they want to continue to move forward this weekend.
It's pretty wild. And Dos por Cuatro, they only made it through the first quarterfinal in their last postseason showing. That was in A Coruña, Spain last year. But they are now moving on to the semis. And they will be taking on, I believe it's the winner of the next game, who are actually taking the track right now. That's Atlanta Roller Derby or Texas Roller Girls. That's going to be quite the matchup. Now, that game's not going to be on Twitch, but guess what? If you've got a watch pass, you can keep watching, and we'll be raffling that off in just a moment.
Yeah.
Tober will have those details. We do want to send a thank you once again to everyone joining us on Twitch. We appreciate your questions. We've loved being here with you. And wow, that game was too short, Tober.
It was. It went so fast. They always do. Don't forget, you can buy a pass for just this weekend, an individual pass, or you can buy the Hydra Bundle, which is a great deal for both playoffs. So this one, the one next weekend in Seattle, and championships, which is November 15th through 17th in Montreal.
The first non-U.S. playoffs, or championships, rather. Yes. So that's really exciting.
You can get them on WFTDA.tv, and we're still going to raffle off a Hydra Bundle pass. But first, when we're ready, we're going to talk to Sissy Splasic, but I can't see quite yet.
She's getting ready. She'll have an interview with one of the skaters of Dos por Cuatro. But yes, what a game. Defensively, though, Dos por Cuatro will definitely need to tighten up because they were much more of an offensive powerhouse, and that's what got them through, They were able to control with Lee Jammer.
And they did a very, very good job of breaking up the tripod or the brace three wall, those little kind of like bundles of blockers you saw throughout. They were able to break Paris's apart pretty easily. Now, Paris is ranked 27th in the world, which is probably underranked considering that they beat the number 5 seed Santa Cruz earlier today. So that's not an easy defense to break up, though it's only going to get harder because Texas Roller Girls or Atlanta are also very, very good defensive teams. So they're going to need to make sure that they're both breaking up those defense and also putting their own together, stopping the other jammer. They can't just kind of out-skate moving through this tournament.
Exactly. And Tober, a reminder of what's at stake, of course. Moving on to the semis, as I said, that's Dos por Cuatro, but they are fighting to be top three because top three gets that championship slot. I mean, everyone should feel great just being here at this playoffs. It means you've entered into a higher level competition in WFTDA because those rankings go from 1 to, 464 different member leagues. So when you're talking about 27th in the world, that's a big pool to come from. And so Paris Roller Girls can definitely feel good about their performance today, and they will have a consolation game tomorrow. But in the meantime, we're going to hear from Sissy Splasic on the sidelines. Sissy?
Hey, I'm Sissy Splasic here with Persephone.
Yes. Hi, how are you doing?
From Dos por Cuatro. What an amazing game. How are you feeling?
Really, really good. Excited, nervous. A lot of feelings are going through my head right now.
Y'all traveled a really long way to be here from Buenos Aires. How did that affect anything? Were you tired? Did you get in early?
Well, half hour ago, like starting the game, we lost our skates. They got in a trunk. We couldn't open the trunk of the car. So we didn't know if we could put a skate with our own skates. I was nervous. I was really nervous because
Yeah, that's a different problem. I feel like usually people are like, we're tired or we're jet lagged. Our skates are locked in a trunk and we may not be able to play is a pretty big deal. What did you do?
So we went to the place where we rented the car and they got it out. But like half hour before we started the game. So I didn't know if I was going to play with my skates or someone else. But unfortunately, we could get it back.
That's amazing. It didn't show. Y'all looked very calm and composed and focused. So congratulations on not letting that get to you. And then it was kind of a penalty heavy game, but from both teams.
Yeah.
Is that how y'all usually play or is that new?
No, that was, we really tried to have the last penalties. It showed different things. We will adjust that things for tomorrow's game, but it's not the way we wanted to. But it can happen.
It can happen.
Do a lot of penalties.
It can happen, and it was both teams, so it really felt like y'all were feeling each other out and learning how to play against each other.
Yeah.
This is important. So you're going to go on to play tomorrow at 6:30 against the winner of this game, so either Atlanta or Texas. Who do you want to play?
Both of them. Like they are our idols. It's a real. They are both great teams. So it will be like a dream come true to play any of those teams. So Texas, Atlanta. It just doesn't matter for us.
That's awesome. Are y'all gonna stay and watch the game?
Yeah, I think so. Well, we will sell merch. So we have our merch booth.
It's exciting, such an amazing game, and I look forward to seeing who you're going to play tomorrow. Congrats.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
All right, I'm Sissy Splasek. This is Persephone, and we're going to go back up to our friends on the dais.
Hi, welcome back. Thanks, Sissy. Now we're going to raffle off our Hydra Bundle, the Hydra Bundle pass for this weekend, for the rest of the games this weekend, the Seattle playoff next weekend,
mm-hmm.
and championships in November. You can use the command Salem, so exclamation point Salem, that's S-A-L-E-M, to enter. Our two-minute contest period starts now.
And if you're wondering why Salem, well, that's because we're broadcasting live on WFTDA.TV on Twitch.TV from Winston-Salem, North Carolina. My first time in North Carolina. It has been a treat being hosted by Greensboro Roller Derby.
Thank you, everyone, so much for being with us. If you have any more questions, now is a good time to hit them up as we wait for the end of this raffle. Also, don't forget to subscribe. You can subscribe to this channel. And we'd love to have you. Please.
Loving all the entries. That's great. Keep them coming. It's going to go for a while. We'll let you know when it ends. So in the meantime, let's have a quick peek at upcoming games. Because, of course, if you win that watch pass or if you decide, hey, you know what, I want to buy it because it is well worth it. You're going to get a lot of roller derby. Just this weekend alone, we're going to enter into the semifinal play of the International WFTDA playoffs.
Mm.
And so the semifinals are going to be a really tight race. We haven't determined yet. Oh, no, we have, rather. So Rainy City Roller Derby from Manchester will be taking on Helsinki. Angel City Derby from L.A. is taking on Bear City Roller Derby from Berlin. That was another upset today, an exciting one for Bear City. And then, of course, we'll determine the final semifinal contestant between Texas Roller Girls and Atlanta. Now, Atlanta comes into this game much like Paris did, having already played a game because they were seeded ninth. They played Bay Area Derby. They had a massive win there, 188-89. Bay Area, though, having had a lot of turnover this season. And so that's always, when you come into the postseason, you have to remember that some of the experiences you may have seen earlier on, well, it's going to be a little different.
Especially because you keep your ranking, right? There is some degradation of games that you've played in the past. So, like, if a lot of people retire, there's some degradation of those games in the rankings over time. But it's not a complete new start every season like some sports. So if a lot of people retire, you might be holding a ranking that's, you know, higher than maybe you feel like you should be ranked, but you play a whole season out.
Exactly. So you could start, of course, at rank 12th or end up a little lower. And then within the tournament, there is the seeding bracket there.
So Angel City Derby is playing Bear City Roller Derby, someone asked. You can go to WFTDA.com. sourmilker.com to find more information about how Rotary works.
Sour Milker.
That's
exciting. We'll see you then for the rest of the weekend. Because your watch pass is good to go. You can also catch up on everything that's happened today if you decide you want a little bit more because, hey, everybody wants a little bit more roller derby.
All right, so it's time to go. You should head on over and buy yourself a watch pass to watch the rest of the games tonight, all the games tomorrow and Sunday. I'm October Revolution.
And I'm Death Nella. It has been such a treat to have you here. Stick around because there's more roller derby action happening on WFTDA.TV. But goodbye for now, Twitch. It's been a blast.